So the condition of the baby is important. If you are pricking the baby immediately and it's not through an arterial line, then the baby may have pain, and hyperventilation affects the carbon dioxide and so on. The perfusion may drop as well, especially if the baby has labile pulmonary pressures. The pulmonary hypertension may drop the PaO2 as well. So it's better to have a line in place for a very sick baby. And if you don't have a line, use comforting measures or oral sucrose, for example, to reduce the pain when you're sampling. The suction has an effect on sampling, but it is overrated. However, if you're planning a timed sample in your unit for a ventilated baby, always do the suction before you sample if there is a suction planned. Suction is a separate topic on ventilation, which I will cover later, but we don't recommend routine suctioning or timed suctioning in most situations. But if it is a small tube, you do need at least one suction per shift or two suctions per shift, the smaller the tube, because you don't want tube blockage as well. And once this tube starts crusting, it's really difficult to remove those secretions. So one or two time suctions per shift is reasonable, and you don't do suction with every care. For example, if you feel there is noise, it's a very poor reflection, because you need to allow the secretions to persist in the airway for a long time before you can hear the conducted sounds increasing. So if you're planning to do the suction, do it first before you sample, because then you take a blood sample for the gas, you see that the carbon dioxide is high, and then you wonder, could it be because of secretions, and you suction and you repeat the sample again, which is a wasted effort. So discuss with your team and time it appropriately. About 15 to 20 minutes after the suction is enough time for the equilibration to happen. Same way, I mean, every ventilator change, setting change, doesn't need a blood gas unless the previous gas was significantly abnormal and the change you're making is difficult to predict. You may need, of course, you can follow the flow and loop curves. You can follow the effort of breathing. You can follow the FAO2 changes to guide you. And if you have made a major change, of course, you need a gas to document. Air contamination and drawback sample contamination we discussed earlier, that heparin may cause increased acidosis, overinterpretation of acidosis. Air contamination will increase the PO2 in the lower levels and drop it in the higher levels, and CO2 contamination will drop the CO2. If you delay in assessing the sample as well, you may have concerns. In terms of neonatal assessment, all sick babies would need an IV cannula insertion. So you have a cannula insertion usually as a first step when you assess the baby. You do a blood sugar, and a blood gas can be part of that as well, because it gives you valuable information. A venous sample is not as accurate because the carbon dioxide is going to be higher, and because the carbon dioxide is higher, the pH also is lower. So the carbonic acid content is more, so the pH will drop. So you should evaluate that, keeping these two points in mind. And the PO2, of course, you would not look at the venous gas for PO2 at all. And because your carbon dioxide is high, the pH is low, the bicarbonate is interpreted from that by the Hasselbeck-Henderson equation. So that is going to reflect this change as well. So always have a correction. The pH of the pH may come down by 0.03 to 0.05 in the venous sample. And in a poorly perfused child, this may be worse. The carbon dioxide again may be 10 centimeter of water higher sometimes. If it is reasonably normal, you can avoid immediate repeat sample. However, if it is abnormal, do not make decisions based on the venous sample, and you should repeat an arterial or a capillary sample before you make a decision to ventilate or correct the acidosis and so on. So the venous gas is like a baseline on which you can decide the overall condition. If it's normal, it's okay. If it's abnormal, you need to repeat to confirm with the appropriate sample. A capillary sample with a warm heel is fairly reliable, and in most babies, once you lose the arterial line, that's the only option we have. The warming of the heel should be stressed on, and you shouldn't burn the heel, obviously. Arterialization of the capillary, we call it, and even then the PO2 is not going to be reliable because it will be lower.